Okay, so today is our great pleasure to have Professor Nagin Qureshi from MIT to give us a talk. So Nagin now is an assistant professor at the MIT Sloan School of Management. So her kind of research interests are in the area of machine learning, statistical learning, and optimization algorithms and applications to revenue management, pricing, and online markets. So Nagin has received several awards, including the ONR Young Investigator Award and the Google Faculty Research Award and the George Danziger Dissertation Award. So today she's going to talk about the optimal learning for structured abundance.
Okay, thank you very much, Yangyang, for the generous introduction. And thank you everyone for attending my talk. It's a great pleasure to be here and have the opportunity of sharing some of my research with you. So as Yangyang mentioned, today I'm going to talk about optimal learning for a structured bandits, and this is a joint work with my colleague at MIT, Bart Van Parys. So I'm new to Webex, so that's why I think that this is a kind of a small group of us, so then feel free to interrupt me at any point if you have any questions. And I also appreciate your feedback, because this paper is under review, and any comments that you might have could help us improve the paper in the next round. Okay, so let me start with setting a stage. So this talk at a very high level related to multi-armed bandits. And multi-armed bandits is a framework that allows us to study online decision making under uncertainty. But let me provide you some background about multi-armed bandits. In multi-armed bandit frameworks, there's a gambler who faces a set of slot machines, as you can see here. So the gambler does not know which slot machine is going to give him the highest average reward. And because of that, the gambler in every round try to pull an arm associated with one of these slot machine and observe the reward of that particular slot machine. And the goal of the gambler is to identify the slot machine with the or the arm with the highest expected reward, and that would allow the gambler to maximize his total profit that he's going to. So while the gambler is trying to do that, there's this fundamental trade-off between exploration and exploitation. So during exploration, the gambler needs to make sure that he collects enough information to discover the best arm. So if he just a gambler, for example, keeps like playing one particular arm, he may miss an opportunity of realizing some other like arm, some other slot machine has better performance. And then there's also exploitation, that the gambler also needs to exploit the collected information to play the arm that seems the best. Otherwise, if the gambler keep exploring, it never really like go to the arm that ha the never like pulls the arm that is the best, and as a result, it's going to lose a lot of money. So one of the nice thing about multi-armed bandit framework is that it can be applied to various applications. And then here I have like a few examples to illustrate that point. So think about healthcare setting. So in the healthcare setting, the gambler is going to be the doctor or physician, and then the arms are going to be drugs. As a physician, we may not know how these drugs are going to perform. Regardless, we keep like prescribing these drugs to different patients in order to identify the drug or the arm with the highest performance. Another example is revenue management, in which we try to identify the best price, I mean the price that maximizes revenue, and in that case we have uncertainty about the revenue under each of the prices that we are experimenting with. So you can think about the arms as the prices, and the goal of the decision maker or the gambler here is to identify the best price. So in online advertising, we have a, like let's say I have a set of ads that I'm trying to experiment with, and each of the ads may have different click-through rates, and then we don't know which one is going to have the highest click-through rate, so we have to experiment with them in order to identify the best ad. So then here you can think about the ads as a set of arms in the multi-arm bandit setting. So what I describe is the classical multi-arm bandit setting, or what I also call it vanilla multi-arm bandit setting. And there's a very important assumption in the classical multi-armed bandit setting. And this assumption is that under this setting, rewards of arms are assumed to be independent of each other. That means that if, for example, the gambler or decision maker learns something from one arm, that information cannot be really used to by the decision maker to learn something about some other arms. But in practice, this is not actually the case. Arms could be correlated with each other or may not be independent of each other. So let me explain why this is happening. This is usually the case because there are some inherent structure in the problem that we are applying the multi-unbounded setting to. So for example, in the healthcare setting, so we expect the drugs that they have similar ingredients to have similar performance. So in that case, if I'm learning information about one drug, I may also learn something from other for other drugs as well. So in revenue management, the structure that we might have is that the demand is expected to go down as price goes up. So again, in that case, if I'm learning some information about one price, that could also tell me something about prices that are higher or lower. So in online advertising, so you may still like have some inherent structure that, for example, you might have some ads that are negatively correlated. So think about ads for a Republican Party versus the ad for a Democratic Party. So then if you're showing these two ads to a population of people, so one expects that if one of these ads is doing a good job and give you high click-through rate, the other ad is not going to do as well. Okay, so and now you agree with me that because of this structural information, the rewards of arm are no longer independent of each other, and just the opposite, the arms are going to be correlated with each other. And then you may wonder again why structural information is important. So this is important because of this correlation that I talk about. And then because of this correlation, structural information allows for some transfer learning between arms. And in particular, if I learn some information about one arm, that information can be transferred to other arms in some way. So, which is, for example, is more obvious for this healthcare setting. If I'm learning some information about one drug, that information can also help me to get some information regarding the drugs that are similar to the drug that I experimented with. So if the structural information is important, let's try to understand how this traditional or classical multi-unbounded algorithms are going to work here. And for those of you who are familiar with this literature, there are two main algorithms in this line of work. One is Thompson sampling. The other one is UCB or upper confidence bound. So if you don't know, it doesn't really matter because I want to tell you about how these algorithms are going to work at their core. So, and then explain why these algorithms are not going to be the best choice when you have a structural information. So these type of algorithms, the way they perform is that they try to collect information, but as soon as they figure out that some arm is not really optimal, if this arm is suboptimal, they are going to stop playing that arm. So you may think, okay, that's a reasonable thing to do. If I realize that some arm is like suboptimal, why should just waste my time and energy on like exploring that particular suboptimal arm? That seems like a good logic to have. But I want to argue that that's not the best logic when you have a structural information. So think about you have some suboptimal arm, which maybe you collected enough information to figure out that arm is suboptimal. But let's say this suboptimal arm is highly correlated with many arms in your set that you are experimenting with. So in that scenario, if you just play that suboptimal arm, you may get a lot of information about other arms. And hence, it might be still like beneficial to keep playing the suboptimal arm. But those like traditional algorithm like Thompson sampling or upper confidence bound, don't allow us to do that, and as a result they have been shown in literature not to be good for a structure bandit when you have this structural information. Okay, so now then the question is that how I'm going to deal with the structural information if these traditional algorithms are not going to work out. So there's a typical approach in the literature. And that typical approach is that they said, okay, let me just focus on one particular structural information. For example, let me assume that the average reward of the arm can be represented as some linear function. And I don't know the parameter of the linear function, but let me assume that it is linear, for example. And then given this very particular structural information, let me try to design an algorithm that try to exploit that particular structural information. And yeah, this is an approach in the literature, but that's not the approach we are taking in this work. In our work, what we want to do is that we want to provide a unified framework that works well for any convex structural information. So you give me an it's become more clear what I mean by convex structural information. But then what we are hoping to get, which seems like a very overarching goal, is that you give me any structural information, and then as long as I can represent it in a, like a convex set that I'm going to define it later, you can apply our algorithm and obtain almost optimal performance. So this is the approach we are taking. Any question about the overall approach?
So just to clarify here, when you say the structure a linear or the convex thing, it's about the reward function or about something else?
Oh, very good question. I think like in this typical approach, the structural information is for the average reward of the arm. So people assume that the average reward of the arm, for example, like has this linear structure, or they assume that it's Lipschitz, in a sense that if I have two arms that are close to each other in like some metric space, I expect their average reward to be close to each other. So first of all, they only impose a structure on the average reward. Also, they just focus on a specific structure. So for example, like there's paper, like several papers written on just specifically on Lipschitz banding, and several papers written on like only linear structure banding. But here I'm saying that, let me just not specific on one particular structural information, and then try to be as general as possible, and then see that if there's a way for me to exploit that structural information.
I see.
Does it answer
Thank
your
you.
Question?
Yeah.
So it's become more clear when I go over the model, but thank you for your question. Okay, so now here's a model. I have a set of a finite set of arms X that they have unknown reward distribution, and that goes back to my earlier point about having uncertainty when it comes to decision making process. So there's a decision maker or a gambler that needs to pull one of these arms per round over the course of T rounds that we have. And reward of arm X in round T is going to be R with certain probability PR of X. And this reward distribution is unknown to the decision maker. Now, given this reward distribution, there's an optimal arm X star of P that has the highest average reward. And the decision maker goal is to identify this optimal arm kind of as soon as possible. But while the decision maker tries to do that, it's trying to balance exploration and exploitation. And in particular, the goal of decision maker is to minimize his regret, where the regret of like a policy pie that is being used by the decision maker over the course of T rounds for this like reward distribution P is going to be the best reward in hindsight, which obtained if you just as a decision maker keep playing the optimal arm X star of P minus the total obtained reward under policy pie. So then usually like we want the regret to be to scale sublinearly in T because it's a cumulative regret. And if that regret is sublinear in T, that means that the per round regret as T goes to infinity is going to go to zero, which is a good thing because that means that eventually as a decision maker, I would identify the optimal arm because the per round regret is going to go to zero. Okay. Now, let me also try to write down the regret in a different form because that form is going to be quite useful in the rest of the talk. So I'm going to write that regret as the sum over all the arms. And then in the summation, I have nt of x, which is going to be the number of times we pull rx during the t rounds. And then delta x of p is going to be the gap between expected reward of rx and the optimal rx star of p. So pretty much I'm telling you that if you play rx, which is like, let's say this arm is suboptimal, every time you play that, this is the regret, this delta is the average regret you are getting. So then to make sure that your regret is small, we need to make sure that we don't really pull suboptimal arms too many times. And eventually we identify the optimal arm. Okay, so now you may wonder what happened to the structural information because what I described is just as a classical multi-unbanded study. So the way that we define the structural information that allows us to have this very flexible framework is that We assume the reward distribution P belongs to some convex set, calligraphic P, which is known to the decision maker. So let me explain, give you like a few examples to make it clear. So for the healthcare example, if you remember the structure that we had is that if I have like two drugs, for example, D1 and D2, that they have similar ingredients, I expect their performance to be similar. So in that case, I can write this calligraphic P as a set of distribution Q, such that under this Q, the expected reward under drug D1 minus the expected reward under drug D2 is going to be less than equal delta. And of course, this set is there is a convex set. And another example is online advertising. So remember, I wanted to model a negative correlation between two types of ad. For example, if I have a Democratic ad versus Republican ad, so then I want to model a negative correlation. So the way that one way to do that is that I would say this calligraphic set P is going to be all the set of all the distribution Q under which the expected reward under XD, which is the ad associated with the Democratic Party, plus the expected reward under Republican ad, is going to be less than equal delta. So if one of them is large, I expect the other one to be small. So again, as you can see, this gives me a convex set and fits into our framework. But these are just two examples. The nice thing about our framework is that using this like convex set P, I can model all the structured bandits in the literature, including linear model, convex bandits, which is not, I think the name of the convex bandit could be a bit confusing. This is the convex bandit would be a special case of this calligraphic P. Lipschitz bandit, you know, model bandit, you name it, like everything can be fitted and can be modeled using this convex set calligraphic P. And other thing I want to mention that goes back to the Yang Yang's question is that all the existing structure bandits only impose a structure on the average reward of the arms. So here in these two examples that I have here, I also impose a structure only on the average reward of the arm, but I have the flexibility of going beyond imposing a structure on the average reward of the arm. And we have examples in the paper to do that. So here, as I said, I can impose a structure even on the entire reward distribution. For example, tell you that if I have some arms that are kind of close to each other in some metric, I expect their distribution to be, for example, close to each other instead of their average reward to be close to each other. Or I can also impose a structure on their second moment or even third moment. I can go beyond the average reward, and that's not something that the prior work could handle. But this, by having this convex set calligraphic P, we have that flexibility as well. Any question about how we model a structural information? So if there is no question, then now I want to summarize our contribution. So given this model that we came up with, we designed a unified learning algorithm for a structured bandit. Our algorithm, we call it dual structure-based algorithm or DUSA, and we show that that algorithm obtains an optimal regret bound for any convex structural information. So at the core of this algorithm, we mimic the dual counterpart of the regret lower bound in order to incorporate a structural information. So we show that the algorithm is computationally efficient because it only needs to solve a convex problem in logarithmic number of runs. And in summary, I would say that our algorithm is the first universally optimal algorithm for a structured bandit that is also computationally tractable. So since I discussed our contribution, let me also briefly talk about related work. So as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, so usually the typical approach to the literature is that we focus on particular structural information. For example, linear structure, Lipschitz structure, like structural information for contextual bandits, structural information in revenue management, and like given the structural information, you know, in any of these settings, so people try to exploit that structural information and design algorithm that is just particularly is tailored to that structure. But we are taking a different approach. We are thinking about taking the unified approach. And then when it comes to taking a unified approach, there are a few works in the literature that took a similar approach. One is by Compass et al. 2017. So their algorithms also mimic the regular lower bound, but they have to solve a semi-infinite optimization problem in every run. Like that means that in T run, like they need to solve semi optimization problem for T runs. But for us, we only need to solve a convex optimization problem in log of T runs, which is a great improvement. On top of that, because of the fact that they have to solve semi-infinite optimization problem, they cannot really go beyond certain like structural information. They just they have to stick to a set of the structural information under which the semi-infinite optimization problem can be easily solved. But we like using our convex problem that we can go beyond those limited structural information. And also this work can only impose a structural information on the average reward of the arm, but we can also impose a structure on the entire reward distribution. Okay, so there's also another word which is also related to our setting, not from the type of approach we are taking, but in terms of like thinking about the unified approach. So that work is by Rosso and Van Roy 2018. So the way that they're thinking about kind of coming up with an algorithm that for a structured bandit, they said, okay, whenever I'm pulling an arm, I have to think about how much reward I'm getting and how much information I'm getting about all the like all the reward distribution, for example. Then they try to balance the reward gain with the information gain. And based on that, they come up with some algorithm. But the algorithm is not obvious that they obtain the optimal regret bound. So that, and then, but in our world, we show that our algorithm from the regret perspective is optimal. Okay, so let's get to the exciting part of the talk, in which I'm talking about our how we can design a policy for any structural information. So the main idea here is that since this is, I want to do well for any structural information, the idea here is to mimic something that directly encapsulates structural information. So then how about like mimicking the information theoretic regret lower bound? So what is this information theoretic regret lower bound? This information theoretic regret lower bound tells us that if you want to be good, uniformly good, for any problem instance, regardless what in problem instance I give you, if you want to be good in the sense that you get sublinear regret for any problem instance, so it's actually impossible to obtain an asymptotic regret better than C of P times log T. So first of all, it tells us that in the base case, your regret is going to scale logarithmically in T, and also tells you that there's a constant in front of log T that is kind of tells you how difficult the problem is. And then this C of P, as I'm going to talk about it, that C of P encapsulates all the structural information. And in particular, the C of P is regret lower bound. It's going to, I'm going to refer to it as a regret lower bound, but of course, regret lower bound has the log T as well. So this C of P is a solution to an optimization problem itself, where in this optimization problem, we try to minimize regret. Let me explain why. So because here is a summation over all the arms. So you can think about eta of x as the logarithmic rate with which we are exploring some suboptimal arm x. And there is this delta x of p, which if you remember from the definition of the regret, was the gap between arm x and then optimal arm x star of p. So pretty much like here, like in C of p, I'm minimizing regret, which makes sense. And then there's a constraint which is quite important, and that constraint is we call it like sufficient exploration condition. So what is the sufficient exploration condition? This condition is just at a very high level encapsulate all the structural information, but you may wonder how it actually encapsulate all the structural information. So let me explain how this condition actually works and how it encapsulates all the structural information. Okay, so then under this condition, we need to make sure that we have done enough exploration such that we can distinguish the true reward distribution P from some deceitful distribution. So what are those deceitful distribution? Those are the distribution that can happen. They belong to this convex set P. And then they have the same distribution at x the star of p at the optimal optimal arm. There the distribution under this deceitful set, and then is the same as the distribution as the true distribution as the true reward distribution p. But deceivingly, they have some better arm x prime to play. Now let's just pause here to understand why it is important for me to distinguish p from this deceitful distribution. It is important to do that because if I don't manage to distinguish p from this deceitful distribution, I may wrongfully think that some distribution in this set of deceitful distribution is the true distribution. And if I wrongfully think that's the case, I may also wrongfully think that some other arm x prime is the optimal arm. And then in that scenario, I would keep playing that particular arm, and hence I would like get a linear regret, which is not a good thing. That's why it is essential to be able to distinguish p from this deceitful distribution. And mathematically, what it means that I need to make sure that I have done enough exploration such that the distance between p and these deceitful distributions are going to be greater than equal one. Here I visualize that. So here is the, you can think about the set of deceitful distribution in this green area. And here is the true reward distribution. I need to make sure that distance between these two, between p and this set, is greater than equal one. So I didn't tell you what this distance is. It's for now you can think about it as a KL divergence. And but you also may wonder, where is this one is coming from? Why you put like one? So this is coming from like, this is related to some optimal hypothesis test. And then the one is coming from that. But that's not the focus of the today's talk. So because I just want to make sure that the distance between P and the deceitful distribution is going to be large enough. And that's what we need to put it back in the regret lower bound. And now if you think about that condition, this distance function, because of this deceitful set, depends on the convex set calligraphic P. And that's why I was telling you that this sufficient exploration set kind of encapsulate all the structural information that we were interested in. So now let's go back to the regret lower bound. So here is the sufficient exploration condition. We need to make sure that the distance between P and the deceitful set is going to be greater than equal one. And then, as I said, this regret lower bound contains and uses a structural information. And that's why it's a good candidate for mimicking purpose when it comes to kind of exploiting a structural information. Let me pause here to see if there are any questions. Is the notion of the regret lower bound clear, and how it encapsulates the structural information? Okay, so if it's clear, I'll move to the next slide. Because in the next slide, I want to tell you about what I exactly mean by mimicking regret lower bound. So is there a question? So let's say that I have the optimal solution to the regret lower bound problem. I'm going to denote it by eta of p. And then now if I want to mimic the regret lower bound, what it means that this I need to pull suboptimal arm x, eta this amount of round, so eta x of p log t. Remember, eta was the logarithmic rate in which I need to explore the some suboptimal arm. So then by mimicking the lower bound, pretty much that means that I have to pull the suboptimal arm this many rounds, eta x of p times log t. But wait a second, so there's a very big issue here, because the regret lower bound is not even available. If you even like look at the notation, the regret lower bound depends on the true reward distribution p, but I don't have the true reward distribution. If I had the true reward distribution, the problem would be simple. I would know the optimal arm, and I would just simply go ahead and play x star from the beginning. So, but then I don't have the true reward distribution, and hence I don't even know the regret lower bound. So then the question is, can we even like mimic the regret lower bound, because that's not even available. So then our very high level idea is that it would say, okay, I know the regret lower bound itself is not available, but how about we compute the empirical reward distribution p of t and follow the empirical regret lower bound c of pt? So instead of like, which I mean like by empirical regular normalcy of PT, I mean like find the solution, like the eta associated with this like optimization problem, and try to kind of mimic this eta at the empirical reward distribution. And this idea is going to work out as long as the empirical reward distribution converges to P. So if that happens, we know that the empirical regular lower bound C of PT is also going to converge to the actual regular lower bound. And the whole idea of the mimicking is going to work. Okay. So this is the very high level idea, but it turns out that implementing that idea is not as easy as we thought it would be. So in particular, we face three main challenges. So the first challenge is that, as I'm going to explain it and convince you, solving regular lower bound is computationally very expensive. So, and if I want to mimic that, so maybe I need to solve this regular lower bound at the empirical distribution, at the empirical reward distribution, like maybe every round, and that's not going to be nice at all. So let's see how we manage to overcome the first challenge. But before like explaining how we overcome the first challenge, let me first convince you that why solving regular lower bound is a challenge, is a computationally expensive problem to solve. Okay, so remember that was the regular lower bound. I needed to minimize regret, and then I needed to make sure that the distance between P, the true reward distribution, and then the deceitful set is going to be greater than equal. So, and if you remember, I said, okay, I did not tell you what this distance function is, but this distance function actually can be obtained by solving another optimization problem, in particular a minimization problem, where in that minimization problem, we minimize weighted KL divergence between P and any deceitful distribution Q. Okay, so so given that this constraint involves solving a minimization problem itself, so that the overall optimization problem that I have is a nested optimization, or is a semi-infinite optimization problem. Okay, so because I would have like infinite number of constraints to consider. So, and that such optimization problem is not usually easy to solve. So then the idea that we have is that we say, okay, let me just dualize this distance function alone. And then after I dualize this distance function, I would obtain the dual counterpart of the regular lower bound, which is no longer difficult to solve. And here is the dual counterpart of the regular lower bound, which is convex and is also finite. So this dual counterpart, it can be written in this form. I still want to minimize regret, but instead of saying that the distance being greater than one, I have some dual function to be greater than or equal one, where this dual function is not like a function with a closed form. So there is no notion of, there is no inner minimization going on here. And then as a result, the overall dual counterpart of regular lower bound is going to be convex and easy to solve. Okay, so that's how we solve the first problem. We look at instead of solving the regular lower bound, we solve its dual instead, which is nice, it's convex and it's finite. And then let's look at the second challenge. So for the second challenge, I said, okay, I know I did the conversion. Instead of going with the semi-infinite optimization problem, I went with the dual version, which is give me a convex optimization problem. But I still don't want to solve the regular lower bound in every single round, because that would make the algorithm not very practical, because it involves a lot of computational power. It would need a lot of computational power. So let's see how we can avoid solving the regular lower bound, even its dual version, in every single round. And this is the idea that actually, like, pretty much, like in that paper, this is the kind of the main idea I really like. So to overcome the same challenge, we made this observation that you don't really need to resolve the regular lower bound if you have already obtained enough information. In particular, if you can distinguish the empirical reward distribution PT from the deceitful distribution. So in that case, it seems like we are good. Like, we have done enough exploration and there is no need for me to reevaluate the regular lower bound. And that means that, like, you need to maybe you can need to test that, like figure out if the distance between PT and the seat full set is greater than equal one. Maybe you don't have to solve the regular one. Okay, that's the idea. And then based on that, maybe you can come up with a simple test. But it turns out that checking that, if you remember, this distance function was a minimization problem itself. Checking that and coming up with a test based on that condition can be quite demanding. Okay, and then I don't really want to replace one convex optimization problem with another convex optimization problem. I would need a much simpler test. Okay, and here is how we came up with a simpler test. We design a test which is not in a, is a one-dimensional convex program, and then that we call it information test. In that test, instead of looking at the distance between PT and this deceitful set, which is going to be this like green set, I'm looking at the distance between the empirical reward distribution PT and a hyperplane H that contains this deceitful set, as I'm also showing that in that figure. And as long as this distance between PT and the hyperplane is greater than or equal one, I would say, okay, it seems like I have done good enough. I have done enough exploration, and I, as a result, I don't need to resolve the regular lower bound at all. And the way we came up with this, like this information test, is using duality theory. And then again, using duality theory, we show that that simple test can be written as a one-dimensional convex optimization problem that you can solve it by using bisection technique. And it turns out that if you show that the distance between PT and its hyperplane is greater than or equal one, that would automatically tell you that the distance between PT and the seatful set is going to be greater than or equal one. So it's like a more conservative test. But as we are going to see, that's going to be good enough. And also in our numerical studies, we observed that since it's a one-dimensional information test, solving that optimization problem, it's very easy, and it does not need a lot of computational power. And it can be done very nicely. Okay, so now let's look at the third challenge. And the third challenge, it just goes back to the main idea of the mimicking regular lower bound. We needed to make sure that the empirical reward distribution PT converges to P. And then as a result, the whole idea of mimicking the empirical regular lower bound is going to work out. So the question is that how do we make sure that the PT converges to P? Perhaps you have guessed the answer to that question. And then to like the way we overcome this challenge. So to overcome that challenge, we ensure that no arm is completely unexplored. Because if there are some arms that is fully unexplored, so in that case, my empirical reward distribution PT might be like too far from the true one. And then to make sure that there is no arm that is completely unexplored, I make sure that the arm that is least played, the number of times that the least played arm is played, is not like too small. Okay, I don't have like then if that condition. If I find an arm that is not played enough in a given run, I try to prioritize that arm and pull that particular arm, and then that would allow me to make sure that the PT converges to the true reward distribution P. Okay, so and that's how we overcome the third challenge. We make sure that we have done enough exploration so that PT does converge to P. Now let me put everything together. This is the algorithm, right? So here, for every run t, after like the total number of arms till t, because we need the first initialization phase. So, but after that, after initialization phase, for every run t, what you do is that you first conduct this sufficient information test. You check if you have collected enough information or not. And in particular, you solve this one-dimensional information test that calculates the distance between PT and this hyperplane H. And then if that distance is greater than or equal one, then you would say, okay, it seems like I have done a good job already. And then in that case, you just simply go and exploit the information you have collected so far by playing the best arm given the empirical reward distribution PT. If the test fails, then you try to see that if there is an arm that is not played enough, and here epsilon you can think about as the parameter that tells you to what extent you want to explore. And here ST is the number of exploration rounds. So if you find an arm that is not explored enough, you try to prioritize that arm by pulling that particular arm, the arm that is least played. And if you couldn't find such an arm and you think that you are on track in terms of exploration, you would solve the dual regret lower bound. This is like convex optimization problem that I show you. That would give you a target rate eta at this empirical reward distribution PT. And then you would go ahead and play the arm that is most behind compared to this eta, this target rate that you have in mind that is coming from the regret lower bound. In particular, you play an arm that minimizes this ratio, the number of times that arm X is played, divided by the target rate. So if there's an arm that is not really on track in terms of this target rate, you try to prioritize it. Okay. Now you may wonder, how did I use the structural information? The way we use the structural information is actually here, because I'm solving the dual regret lower bound. And this dual regret lower bound contains and encapsulates all the structural information, allows me to exploit the structural information in a very implicit way. And then, as you can see in that step, I'm trying to follow the suggestion made by the regret lower bound. And that would allow me to use the structural information. Any question about the algorithm?
So I have a question here. So I'm trying to understand your algorithm.
Yes, please.
So you first check if you have collected enough information, right? Basically check that distance mm-hmm. is greater or equal to one.
Yes.
And then you have two cases, right? Yes, you use exploitation. Then otherwise do the exploration, right?
Yes. So if the test passes, meaning that for every arm x prime, this distance is greater than equal one, then
yes.
that means that I don't need to solve the regret lower bound, and no exploration is not really required. First of all, exploration right. is not required. I also don't have to go back and revisit my regret lower bound So then in that case, I'm just going to go with the arm that has the best empirical average reward. Highest empirical average reward, and
yeah, that part. And I'm confused with the last part. You say if not you pass that information test.
Which part?
You have four lines here, right? The last line you say if not you solve this dual
regret.
So then if not to.
Oh, very good. So not test? Meaning that. If I could not find any R.
Oh, okay. Okay, if not over there, I see.
Yeah, okay, so sorry.
Under the exploration.
Yeah, and within the exploration, if I couldn't find any R that is kind of satisfy that condition, and that means that if I could not find an arm that is not fully, if every arm is on track in terms of exploration, then I would come here and I would try to go with the suggestion of the regret lower bound. So this not goes back to that. If I could not find such an arm, I would come here and solve the dual regret lower bound.
I see. You know, another thing to clarify, so in your problem, somehow you have the summation over the reward R. Do you assume that the rewards are just in the finite set?
Oh, very good question. I think we assume that the reward is in the finite set, but then we can extend that if you have a parametric reward distribution, like something like normal or like Bernoulli, something that you can represent by a few parameters, we can have a continuous set of rewards. I can do the integration, but for this one, like for what I'm presenting for now is just, I'm assuming, as you mentioned, the set of arms is final, but that can be extended.
I see. Thanks.
Very good question. Wonderful. Any other questions? Okay, so then let me go to the main theorem. So then we show that under mild assumption on the reward distribution P, for any accuracy parameter, this epsilon that determines to what extent I want to do exploration. So do so has the following two properties. The first thing is that it obtains optimal asymptotic regret. So if I calculate the regret, the ratio of the regret to log t and take the limit of t goes to infinity, excuse me. So I show that that ratio is going to be less than equal 1 plus epsilon C of P, which is the actual reward distribution, the actual regular lower bound plus sum of epsilon. So here I cannot set epsilon equal to zero because that means that I am not going to explore at all, and that would break down the mimicking idea. But I can set epsilon very small. So in our numerical studies, for example, we choose it like 1/1000. So which is a very small number. And then we observe that our algorithm is not very sensitive to the choice of epsilon. In any case, what I want to highlight here is that for now, assume that epsilon is just zero. Of course, I cannot literally make it zero, but let's assume that it just goes and become very close to zero. So in that case, what this theorem tells me that this regret of the do so is going to be less than equal C of P. And that's C of P, of course, times log T. And then that means that the regret of do so matches the regret lower bound, and hence it's optimal. And I have this optimality condition for, as I mentioned, for a wide range of structural bandits, for any like convex set calligraphic P that fits our framework, we can have this optimal regret bound. Another result that we have is that we show that the number of rounds during which we enter the exploration round, and that's a part when the information test fails. So the number of exploration rounds is going to be in the O of log T. And this is important because only during exploration rounds, I may end up solving the regret lower bound, the dual counterpart of the regret lower bound. And that makes our algorithm from the computational perspective tractable. And that the reason that we get that is just because of our information test. So information tests make sure that we don't really solve the regret lower bound, the bounds that are not necessary. And despite that, we still manage to obtain the optimal regret bound. Any question about the result, the main theorem? Okay, so if there's no question, let me also walk you through the proof outline. So here I'm hiding a lot of like details. It's just the sketch of the proof. The proof is a bit like challenging because we have to show the continuity of the regular lower bound itself, which is an optimization problem, semi-infinite optimization problem. So because of that subtle issue, which is actually was very important for our idea of the mimicking to work out, the proof was quite long and involves a lot of steps. But then let me just tell you the high level idea behind the proof. So we decompose the regret into two parts, regret during exploitation and regret during exploration. So during exploitation, we show that because of our information test, every time we pass the test, we are kind of very good. So either we are pretty much like pulling the optimal arm, and hence we show that the regret in that case is going to be finite. So during exploration is the part that we are capturing the kind of the dominating term in the regret bound, which was 1 plus epsilon C of P times log T. And to show that the regret during exploration round is that much, we divide it into two sub cases. And the first sub case is that when the reward distribution is not very, the empirical reward distribution is not very close to the true one. And then for that one, we show that our regret here is going to be finite because the probability that this happens is small. Then we focus on the case when the empirical reward distribution is very close to the true reward distribution, so that using our continuity argument, the solution to the empirical regret lower bound is eta of pt is close to the eta of p, which is the solution to the actual regret lower bound. So in that case, if I just want to show you a few lines, here's our regret. We can write the regret in terms of the summation over all the suboptimal arms. And this is the gap. This is the suboptimality gap. And this is like how many times I ended up like playing that particular arm X. Here you think about that term as eta of pt, because eta of pt is very close to eta. I can replace it by eta times 1 plus epsilon. And then I have log t because this is a logarithmic rate. So then automatically you would see that C of P times 1 plus epsilon log T would appear. And that's actually the dominating factor in the regular lower bound. As I said, it just very much like oversimplified the proof, but then here's the kind of the gist of it. The part that I want you to maybe to remember is that the main part of the algorithm that just leads to the highest regret is during the actual exploration. Okay, Okay, so here's another part that is kind of we were quite happy about. This is a part that we did because of the during the revision. So we did some numerical studies for well-known structure bandits because we wanted to see how DUSO performs compared to the algorithms that are very tailored to a specific structure band. So we focus on two type of well-known structure bandits. One is linear and the other one is Lipschitz. So, and here what I'm showing you here is that the normalized cumulative regret. And when I'm saying normalized, I mean we look at the cumulative regret and divide it by the regret lower bound that we could actually obtain. So then ideally this when you do the normalization, you want that number like to be very close to one. So if it is close to one, that means that you matches the regret lower bound. And that's a kind of best scenario. So you will see in all of these cases, pretty much we are very close to one for DUSO and also other algorithms. But one thing I want to highlight is that despite the fact that those algorithms, like for example, this GLM UCB algorithm is pretty much very, very much tailored to linear structure, its performance is very comparable to performance DUSO. So the same thing for the algorithm that are specifically tailored for the Lipschitz bandits. Another thing that was quite interesting to observe is that these DUSO's performance is kind of more stable and its regret is more concentrated around its mean. So the other algorithm, we find like some outliers which are pretty bad. For example, for UCB, there were some outliers that in which the regret of UCB, this GLM UCB was 35 times the regret lower bound. And also the same thing for this algorithm designed for the Lipschitz bandit. There were cases in which their performance was, the regret of those algorithms was 12 times the regret lower bound. So DUSO seems to do a better job in terms of having a lower variance around its median. Okay, so we did also some other simulation for novel structure bandit. That some bandit structure that we came up with that goes beyond the imposing structure on the average reward and imposes structure in particular on the first and second moment of reward distribution. I'm not going to bore you with the details of this specific bandits that we define, but I want to say that, okay, since it's a very new bandit, existing, there is no existing algorithms for a structure bandit that can capture that and we can use it as the benchmark. The only algorithm that we can use is the vanilla UCB algorithm that does not even consider a structure bandit. And then that's a good thing because we can also understand to what extent incorporating a structural information in that particular scenario is going to help us. Okay, so here what I'm showing you is a cumulative regret. I did not do normalization here. I just wanted to maybe show you a different figure. So here is the pink one is for DUSO. And then the gray one is for the UCB algorithm. So here the lower the better. So I want the regret to be lower. So DUSO is doing much, much better job than the UCB algorithm, which is expected because UCB does not even consider a structural information at all. Another thing that we were quite excited about when we did these numerical studies was that there were some rare cases where a CFP in the regret lower bound is equal to zero. And in that case, the regret lower bound suggests that the asymptotically regret should go to zero. And in other words, the regret should not really scale with the number of rounds T. So when we did the simulation, we observed actually one of those cases occur in our data set, in our instances that we generated. So for that case, we try to understand the performance of the DUSO, which is this, the dotted lines, and then the performance of the UCB, which is again, this gray dotted line. What we observe is that, yeah, so DUSO actually manages to get constant regret, a regret that does not scale with the number of rounds. And in other words, it actually matches the regret lower bound for these rare cases. And by the way, these rare cases happens when the set of deceitful distributions are empty. So in those cases, you don't really need to distinguish P from any deceitful distribution. And as a result, the C of P, this regret lower bound, is going to be simply zero. And then we actually show that the DUSO in that case is, manages to get asymptotically zero regret. But as you can see, UCB algorithm that ignores such a structural information is not doing as well. And its regret just keeps growing with the number of rounds. Okay, any question about the numerical studies? Okay, wonderful. So I don't know how well I'm doing in terms of timing, but then I can wrap up the talk now. So here in this world, we provide a unified framework for to study a structured bandits. And then we present an algorithm that we call it DUSA that obtains optimal regret bound for any convex structural information. So DUSA tries to mimic the information theoretically regular lower bound, actually dual counterpart of the regular lower bound, which is a convex optimization problem. And by doing that, we show that the DUSA is going to obtain optimal regret. And hence, DUSA is the first universally optimal algorithm that is also computationally tractable. It only needs to solve this dual counterpart of the regular lower bound in logarithmic number of rounds. With that, I want to thank you guys for listening to my talk. Here's a link to the paper, and here is my email. And now I will take any questions that you might have. Thank you so much, guys.
Okay, thanks a lot for the very, very nice talk.